This presentation is going to look at some of the more common polygamy concerns that are expressed by members of the church. The list includes the fact that polygamy is unfair. There are things about Joseph Smith's motives and practice, things that occurred after Joseph Smith's death, and also concerns about eternal polygamy. Polygamy is unfair. Men can do it, women cannot. There's really no way to defend it as being a fair practice. Historically, though, this hasn't always been a big deal because, at least in Joseph Smith's time, most of society believed in the Bible and that the Bible came from God, and the Bible had polygamy, and therefore people not wanting to accuse God of being unfair would accept it. However, as we have watched over the past few decades, America has become a post-Christian nation, and secularism, atheism, naturalism is growing so that the inequality between the ability of men to do it and women can't is something that is not going to be able to be ignored. In the 1880s, some Latter-day Saint polygamists did defend plural marriage, and they made observations that it allowed all women to have a family, to be part of a family and protected. It allowed some women to leave a polygamous family and get law degrees or medical degrees. But privately, these women, most of them, were concerned about plural marriage and the inequality that it had as a dynamic in the family. I've had a sister tell me that she could not believe in a God who would command something as unfair as polygamy. And if Latter-day Saints approach us with this question, how do we respond? The answer comes from Elder Dale Renlund in the last General Conference. He said, "Mortal life is inherently unfair. Some people are born in affluence, others are not. Some have loving parents, others do not. Some live many years, others few." Then he remarks, "All unfairness, especially infuriating unfairness, will be consecrated for your gain." And so it's easy as we understand that from our vantage point here in mortality, we cannot understand how God is fair, but for us it appears that he is not. And it is, I think, easier to understand how he could command a practice that appears unfair to us now. And yet, when we are able to see everything as he does, we can understand the purposes for this apparent unfairness. That we only see the second act of a three-act play, to quote Elder Maxwell. Some people are concerned about Joseph Smith's motives, and this is understandable because if I were to stand on a street corner in any large American city and ask the question, "Joseph Smith introduced polygamy among the Mormons. Why do you think he did it?" virtually everybody will respond that he wanted to expand his sexual opportunities. He wanted sex. That he was driven by libido. And we understand this response, this cynicism. We see charismatic males, religious leaders of the past, like David Koresh or Jim Jones, who eventually are sleeping with their followers. And then, of course, there's Warren Jeffs, who transformed Joseph's teachings into some of the darkest perversions that the Restoration has known. But this idea is not new to us. Even in 1903, over 100 years ago, President Joseph F. Smith recognized, saying, "It is difficult to convince a prejudiced mind that any but base intents and impure desires prompted the practice of plural marriage, but nevertheless, it was entered into, God knows, with the highest religious and moral motives." In other words, it's difficult to believe that an angel appeared to Joseph. It's even more difficult to believe that the angel was commanding a practice like polygamy. It connects religion and sexuality to hot-button topics in any age. And so for a person to naturally respond saying that it was libido-driven, it's going to be the default mode or the natural response of the natural man or the natural woman. So how do we deal with this? because these are feelings that the youth may have, even some members besides those outside of the church. I think one way is to provide context for how Joseph Smith introduced it and how plural marriage was practiced in the church. Lorenzo Snow remembered Joseph hesitated and deferred from time to time. Eliza R. Snow described Joseph as afraid to promulgate it. Helen Mark Kimball recalled Joseph put off the dreadful day as long as he dared. Lucy Walker reported Joseph had his doubts about it, for he debated it in his own mind. And most importantly, for Joseph and the other polygamists, plural marriage was a religious practice commanded by God. Scholar Kathleen Flake, when asked, "Do I think Joseph Smith's revelations on polygamy can be reduced to his sex drive?" responded, "No, I don't. It's too simplistic. There are so many easier ways to satisfy our sex drive than to have many marriages." And if you go to our website, josephsmithpolygamy.com, you'll find many of the members' reactions and stories of faith that are, I think, fairly convincing that these people are sincere and that it is, in fact, a religious practice for them. And if Joseph had at any time hinted that there were other motives involved, they would not have accepted him and would have dumped him, I think, quite quickly. What about Joseph Smith's practices? There are a number of them that have become controversial, some of them understandably so. And we will look at all of these now. Fanny Alger, polyandry, sexuality and children, young wives, Emma, ceilings to many wives, and the alleged lying for the Lord. Fanny Alger, she was in Kirtland, Ohio. She was the first plural marriage, probably late 1835, early 1836. She was probably 19 years old. We don't have a date for the marriage ceremony. Joseph Smith received permission from Fanny's parents. That doesn't sound like a liaison or something that was a spur-of-the-moment interaction. A marriage ceremony was performed, and those who heard about the ceremony from Joseph, particularly Emma and Oliver, rejected its validity, while those who heard about it from Fanny, including her family, her uncle's family, the Webb family that she went to stay with after she left the Smith home, and Eliza R. Snow, who was well acquainted with Fanny Alger and lived there at the time, they all believed it was valid. Fanny left the church and remarried, had a large family outside of the church. She became a Universalist. The Algers, Hancocks, and Webb families, who all knew the details, stayed active in the church and moved to Utah with the saints. What about a plurality of husbands, also called polyandry? But I don't use the word polyandry because it's so easily misrepresented or confused. In the context for the Nauvoo polygamists, there's just no evidence a woman in Nauvoo ever believed she had two husbands simultaneously. There's no references to a new revelation or a new teachings authorizing it. There's no justification offered by anyone, including Joseph Smith, of how they could ignore Romans 7, verses 2 and 3, which unambiguously condemn a plurality of husbands. None of the alleged participants ever defended it, and there are no unambiguous supportive evidences. Members and leaders have always taught that a plurality of husbands was adultery. If we look at it from the critic standpoint, there's an elephant in the room, because a plurality of husbands would have been far more controversial than a plurality of wives. It would have been explosive, and yet no critic complained during Joseph's lifetime or for years thereafter. Not John C. Bennett. He wasn't a polygamy insider, but he was close. And not William Law, who was a polygamy insider and published the Nauvoo Expositor and did not make the accusation or any reference to such a practice. What was going on? Well, we know about time only. Civil marriages were performed in Nauvoo. Joseph introduced time and eternity marriages, and then there were a few eternity only ceilings that were only for the next life. Many of these were women who were legally married to non-members, but some of them were actually active members, and we don't know why they chose Joseph for their eternal ceilings, but those are the ones that would only have been marriages after death. There's a saying from John C. Bennett that Joseph would send men on missions in order to marry their wives. This is false. Of the 14 legal husbands, 10 were not on missions. 3 of the marriages are undated. The only possible case has 2 different dates for the woman sealing to Joseph. What about sexuality and children in Joseph Smith's plural marriages? Section 132 gives 4 reasons that polygamy could be practiced: as part of a restitution of all things, as a customized trial for that time and place, to expand the opportunities for worthy individuals to be sealed in marriage and become candidates for exaltation, and also to multiply and replenish the earth. Having children is not the entire focus, but it is one of the reasons that plural marriage could be introduced. On the website, we have this chart that shows that there is excellent evidence for 3 of the women who testified under oath regarding their relationship with Joseph, and then there's moderate evidence for sexuality in some of the other marriages. If you go to the website, there's also this chart wherein many children have been assumed to be Joseph's offspring, but the most likely 8 have all been shown through genetic testing to not be his children, and there are problems with the others. There are rumors that he had some plural children, but none of them have been identified. This chart is very busy, but all of Joseph's sealed wives are in the left-hand column, and even the women who left the church, none of them left complaints against Joseph Smith that he had been using them, that this plural marriage was a cover-up for debaucheries. Joseph Smith and these women practice plural marriage, as near as we can tell, as a religious practice. In summary, there are no children that have been documented. By all indications, sexuality was uncommon. There's no evidence that sexuality was a primary focus of the relationships. Many of the women remarried after the martyrdom and bore numerous children to their husbands, suggesting if Joseph were having relations with them often, children would have been documentable. There's no evidence Joseph used sexually oriented slang language. Most Nauvoo polygamists remain devout religionists. They wouldn't have later been persuaded to lie about their relationships with him simply to satisfy Brigham Young or a desire to make Joseph look like something that he was not. What about the young plural wives? There are 3 that were under age 17. Helen Mar Kimball was 14, and she did not seek the sealing. Joseph did not seek his sealing to her. There's no evidence that Joseph and Helen were ever alone together after the sealing ceremony. The sealing appears to have been more of a betrothal. As an adult, Helen defended Joseph and plural marriage in Utah, and she never taught that she was victimized by Joseph, even though critics today sometimes grab the victim card for her. Joseph Smith's teenage wives, the evidence supports that the sealings to the 14 and 16-year-olds were not consummated. Months after their plural sealing, Joseph and the 16-year-old Flora Woodworth divorced. They had a sealing cancellation as she legally married a non-member. Brides of this age were eyebrow-raising but not scandalous. Utah policy was to wait until the women were 17 or 18, and I believe Joseph initiated that policy. What about Emma Smith? When did she learn about plural marriage? Well, she learned about Fanny Alger and rejected that as a legitimate marriage. Then in 1842, when she was Relief Society president, she did push back against immorality, but at that point in time, there were only 1 or 2 legitimate plural marriages in Nauvoo. And by the end of 1842, there were only 3 men who were involved. So the evidence is she didn't know about plural marriage during this period, and that her comments about immorality were directed at John C. Bennett. She may have learned about eternity-only sealings first, but by the middle of 1843, about the same time Hiram Smith and William Law being a second counselor in the first presidency, about the same time they learned about plural marriage is the time that Emma learned about it and participated in 4 plural sealings. Why did Joseph wait so long? Well, I think the answer is found in verse 64 of section 132. This verse talks about, if any man have a wife who holds the keys of this power, this is the man. And so this verse is just talking about the key holder, Joseph Smith in his day, Russell M. Nelson in our day. And he teaches unto her the law of my priesthood as pertaining to these things. Then shall she believe and administer to him, or she shall be destroyed. So Joseph knew the minute that he taught Emma about plural marriage, she would be at a crossroads moment. And he waited until she did accept it, although within a very short period of time, she struggled mightily. We also recognize verse 56 says, and again, verily I say, let my handmaid forgive my servant Joseph his trespasses. In other words, Joseph was not perfect. He had trespassed against Emma, and he may have actually handled it better. We shouldn't judge him, and yet we shouldn't also expect him to be perfect. As Joseph was leaving Nauvoo for Carthage and martyrdom, he asked Emma to go with him, but because of the children, she couldn't. It was an emotional moment, and Joseph said, I will come back, so write a blessing, and I'll sign it when I return. In that blessing, Emma wrote, I desire with all my heart to honor and respect my husband as my head, ever to live in his confidence, and by acting in unison with him, retain the place which God has given me by his side. Here, Emma, she's a polygamy insider. She knows what's going on. She understands Joseph better than anyone, and she still sustains him as a prophet, even though he is practicing plural marriage. What about the ceilings to more than 30 plural wives? Here is one list, and here are photographs of all of the wives of Joseph Smith's wives that I could identify. And the question is, why didn't he stop at 5 or 10? And the answer is, we simply do not know. God gave Joseph Smith the privilege, he related, of having more wives, and he sought to exercise that privilege. We simply should not expect him to be perfect, but we can expect and we can believe that he was always worthy. What motivated him to have more than a few plural wives may have been ego. It probably wasn't libido, because he was so busy, having more wives wouldn't have necessarily affected his opportunities to spend time with them. But again, it wasn't a sinful practice, but it is one we cannot fully understand at this time. Joseph Smith's alleged lying for the Lord. The term lying for the Lord is loaded language. It implies hypocrisy right from the beginning. And so the critics love to use it. Joseph Smith did introduce secret plural marriage teachings to members of the Quorum of the Twelve when they came back from England in 1841. But as I mentioned, by the end of 1842, there were only three men involved, and that was Joseph, Brigham, and Heber. And then Emma and Hiram and William learned about it in the middle of 1843. And there are many people who are willing to believe that Joseph lied to Emma during 1842. And that he may have lied to Hiram and William Law as well. However, Emma, William Law, and Hiram left no accusations against Joseph Smith that he ever lied to them. So some individuals do assume he lied, and then they condemn him based upon their assumption. But there is no documentation to support this. But did Joseph lie publicly about plural marriage? And this is a common accusation. I recently was reading some anti-Mormon literature, and it indicted Joseph for doing all these bad things, and then towards the end it said, and he lied about plural marriage. Well, I sought to understand these accusations, and a few years ago wrote an article where I compiled every documentable case of a denial by Joseph Smith, by Emma Smith, and by Hiram Smith. And frankly, Joseph's statements I don't think are that problematic, but I do worry more about Hiram's. But the worst, the most egregious denial from Joseph Smith that I could identify is the one that we've all heard many times, what he said a month before his death: what a thing it is for a man to be accused of committing adultery and having seven wives when I can only find one. And as we look at this, is this fully disclosing what's going on? No, it's not. But if he wasn't looking very hard, technically it could be truthful. But more importantly, is the observation that Joseph Smith is trying not to lie. In other words, he's a man caught between a commandment he believes is from God on one hand, and the fact that the state would accuse him not of bigamy, but of open and notorious adultery if he consummated any of these plural marriages, because they wouldn't recognize them as genuine marriages. And so he's trying to be truthful, at the same time not disclosing everything. What about the things that happened after Joseph Smith, after he was martyred? There is some confusion regarding eternal sealings. In the early 1830s, there were people being sealed up to eternal life. This didn't use sealing keys because they came in 1836. But then we eventually learned that those sealing keys can be used for two sealing ordinances. One of those is between husbands and wives. It's horizontal. This ordinance can be performed outside of a temple, and then it should be ratified again in the temple, either by proxy or by the same parties. But there is a second sealing ordinance that is vertical, child to parent, that cannot be performed outside of a temple. Joseph Smith died without being sealed to his children or to his parents. And in the Nauvoo Temple, there were these types of sealings. This is a busy slide. Just notice the right two columns show 82 child-to-parent sealings, and 211 biologically unrelated individuals were sealed as children to parents. Notice here that John D. Lee has 22 people he's not related to sealed to him as his children. As the temple closed towards the end of the 1840s and early 1850s, there were people teaching and believing that the more wives a man had, the more children he had, and the more adopted children that he had, the greater his exaltation in the next life. And there were even apostles politicking to have people be sealed to them. Eventually, though, the sealings that John D. Lee had fell apart because he was hoping that these new adopted children would take care of him, and the children thought that John D. Lee would take care of them. And within a year or two, all of those sealings had been annulled. And by the time the St. George Temple was open in 1877 and these child-to-parent sealings could resume, most of these ideas that more wives or children brought more exaltation had been set aside. In the Gospel Topic Essay on Plural Marriage, it states Joseph Smith's sealings to women already married may have been an early version of linking one family to another. And so the idea of linking families through plural marrying or adoptions, I think, are still something that we may not have all of the clarity on, but we have in 1894 Wilford Woodruff telling us to be sealed to our biological parents as far back as we can go, and that things will be taken care of during the millennium. A second concern after Joseph Smith are sealings that occurred between 1890 and 1904. The commandment was removed through the 1890 manifesto, but secretly, on average, 10 to 12 plural sealings were performed per year. Some years there were none, some years there were several dozen. But publicly, the church leaders were saying, we're not doing plural marriage anymore. And while some of these marriages were performed in Mexico and Canada and even on boats off the California seacoast, there were plural marriages performed in Utah during this period, and it is an embarrassment to us because we were not being forthright with respect to things that were being said. But in 1904, the permission was removed through President Joseph F. Smith. Now, a third concern after Joseph Smith dealing with plural marriage is the following question that many of us have heard and maybe even voiced ourselves. Why did the church not discuss Joseph Smith's plural marriages until recently? If we look at the church's response to plural marriage, we recognize that the permission or the authority was removed in 1904. And then by the 1920s, there were men and women in and out of the church who thought polygamy should be continued. Now, they struggled to try to identify a way to get authority. Having a personal revelation and being very sincere does not create genuine authority, because God's house is a house of order. There's one man who holds the keys. And they became very creative in their ways of claiming authority through men like A. Dyer LeBaron, Lawrence C. Woolley, Eldon Kingston, and others, to say that somehow they had authority. And these lines have been researched, and they're spurious. But and you can learn about these on the website mormonfundamentalism.com. What else was happening, though, is these unauthorized polygamists were forming in the thousands, and they were getting a lot of media attention. In fact, this very long picture here is a picture I brought together in Photoshop that's a two-page spread in Life magazine from the early 1940s, and you don't get any bigger media, really, than Life magazine at that time. And so the church is embarrassed by this, and you can see a policy forming where they are just not going to talk about polygamy, and they're going to try to create as much distance between the fundamentalist polygamists and the church. They don't talk about plural marriage, though John A. Woodso did at one point, but for the most part, it's a practice that is simply not acknowledged or discussed or even researched. They wanted to create this distance because people even today conflate the FLDS and Warren Jeffs with the mainstream church. But then the internet arrives in the early 2000s, and not all of the information on the internet is false. And the church plays catch up for just a few years, and we have the gospel topic essay on plural marriage in 2013. What about concerns regarding eternal polygamy? Is polygamy required for exaltation? Well, we know that section 132, verse 1, is a question about many wives and concubines. Joseph was asking, how does this work? In response, God says, I will give you a new and everlasting covenant. That's how I'm going to answer your question about polygamy. He also adds, if you don't obey it, you will be damned. And so everybody wants to obey this new and everlasting covenant that's going to be revealed in this revelation. And polygamists today will tell you the new and everlasting covenant is polygamy. And that is simply false. In fact, if we look at the first 19 verses, they don't mention polygamy again. I mean, the next 19 do not mention plural marriage again. But verses 19 and 20 tell of worthy monogamous couples who are sealed by genuine priesthood authority. And priesthood authority is very important. It's mentioned over and over. They are promised exaltation. It's for when a man marries a woman. It's monogamy leads to exaltation and godhood. The verbiage couldn't be any clearer in verses 19 and 20. Plural marriage is not a ceremony. It's not a covenant. It's not an ordinance. It's not a law of the priesthood. It is a practice that is a part of the new and everlasting covenant of marriage. It may be permitted or commanded as God directs. We know regarding polygamy and eternity, we know almost nothing about eternal marriage and even less about eternal plural marriage. So worrying about eternal polygamy is worrying about the unknown. Exalted beings are promised a fullness of joy and eternal happiness. Worthy Latter-day Saints can trust these promises. There's a recent book out by Carolyn Pearson, where she is a fearmonger, telling women they essentially should not believe the scriptures that promise eternal happiness, but instead they should worry about eternal polygamy. The power to seal is also the power to loosen. Vicarious and living ordinances will continue prior to the resurrection to assure that all worthy beings are sealed in joyful eternal marriages they have chosen. The vast majority of God's followers since Adam and Eve have lived monogamy, not polygamy. God's prophet has never declared that all exalted beings are polygamists. I would not want to live polygamy, and I do not believe that I will ever need to. On September 18, 2018, Elder Quentin L. Cook of the Quorum of the Twelve said, "In the senior councils of the church, there is a feeling that polygamy, as it was practiced, has served its purpose," adding that it is no longer necessary.